So, welcome to my talk, creating a routable bicycle map for Garmin devices with OpenStreetMap data. About me, my name is Johannes Vormann. I'm working at the University of Duisburg-Essen and I got to the Department for Civil Engineering. I have a PhD in computer science, and if you want to contact me, it's easily done, email, Java, and from time to time I'm checking Twitter too. And if someone in the audience has experience with home automation systems, especially wireless, please talk to me. I'm interested in playing around with them, so I'm interested in information exchange. So, why do I or anyone else want to build a routable bicycle map for Garmin devices? For me, it started a few years ago after I bought a new bicycle and I wanted to make larger tours. And since I have moved before, I wasn't so familiar with the surrounding area. So I thought some GPS device with routing functionality might be a good idea. And then I started to look around, and at that time, the mobile phones were not so advanced and didn't have such good routing functionality, so it more or less boiled down to Garmin and some other hardware vendors that also created maps. So I took a look, and at that time for Garmin devices there was already the possibility to create maps with OpenStreetMap data. So I decided to buy myself a Garmin device. Then I found out that most of the available maps didn't really fit my needs. Some of the maps had other, target groups in mind. For example, the OpenMTB map is very well known, but that's primarily for MTB users, and I don't like cycling up and down hills, so I'm the wrong audience. Other maps had very interesting color schemes I simply didn't like. So in the end, I found one map from a user called Radfahrer that I really liked. The routing was okay-ish. The design, I liked it mostly, but then I found the main problem, it hasn't been updated about half a year. And half a year in OpenStreetMap time, especially in that time, was meaning lots of roads was missing and the data quality hadn't been so good. So I decided, well, he published the build process and all information. Let's take the data and try to build an own map. So let's take a look, what is a routable map from the technical point of view? In the end, it's a graph where the nodes represents points where different roads meet, and the lines between it are the roads or the piece of the roads between them. And of course, it's a rated graph, so you can use different algorithms to check the shortest path. And shortest is not measured in meters or kilometers, but usually determined by the lowest rate. And the interesting question is, how do you determine the rate? And that's, or the rate or the cost. And this, of course, is very different on the mode of transportation you are using. If you're using a car, a detour of a few kilometers over a motorway is a very good idea, because on the motorway you can drive fast. And so if you make a detour on a let's say 100 kilometer drive on 10 kilometers, but you're using mainly motorways, you're usually faster at your destination. But if you're taking a bicycle, 10 kilometers a detour really hurts. And since you're usually driving not faster than 20 or 30 kilometers per hour, the speed limit inside a city doesn't matter to you. You can go at full speed through the city. Then, of course, it's different for different bikers. If you're a road biker, you wanted long periods where you can take the same speed, smooth pavement, good tarmac or asphalt. You don't want many stop signs. If you are make some tour biking, you want a nice atmosphere, green, perhaps a nice river on the side. And if you're downhill or mountain biking, of course, you want as much hills and as much decline as possible, so you can have a good driving experience. So what are the potential influences? I think there are many more, but the main one is, of course, the distance. Even if it's the nicest pass, you don't want to make a 100 kilometer detour if you want to go getting some groceries or something like that. Then, of course, in theory, the incline, because going up and down a hill, especially if cycling, costs a lot of energy. So a small detour, if you stay on the same level, is really, really beneficial instead of going down the valley and up again. Then the surface, smooth tarmac is of course way better to ride than a really old bumpy road or fine sand, which really slows you down. And of course, every time you have to stop at a crossroad, it takes sometimes two, or at least you should stop, and that takes time. So these are influences where you that can define the cost, and how you rate these different influences, of course, result in very different routing decisions, how you are getting from one point to the other. So this is the nice theory. Let's go to the Garmin world. The good, the bad, and the worst. It's undocumented, but fortunately, some people had put lots of effort into it to reverse engineer it in some parts. Then the maps have only a very low resolution. The lowest points that can be separated are about 2.3 meters away. So especially if on low zoom levels, if you have, for example, houses, the contour lines look really ugly because the house gets fit in this low resolution map. And it gets even worse if you try to get the routing done. Because if you use the Garmin maps, the Garmin Ray, you have no influence for bicycle routing. If you get a bit more creative, you can use the car routing for bicycles. Because if you create a bicycle map, you know, well, I'm riding with a bicycle, so I tell my Garmin device, I'm a car, and if I'm a car, then I have some influence over the routing decisions. But not very fine. We have five different road classes going from 0 to 4, and the higher road classes are preferred. So if I'm a car, if you make a map for a car, you usually take motorways, for example, for the highest road class. And you have four different speed classes. So you have about 20 different possibilities to tune the weight for a street. And you have some options where you can mark a street in a map, so the user can say it wants to be avoided. You can mark a road as unpaved. You can mark it as a carpool lane. You can mark it as a ferry. And you can mark it as a toll road. I also abused these features. For example, the carpool lanes are really bad roads you usually really want to avoid. And toll roads are streets with, at least as high as you can guess from the OpenStreetMap data, heavy traffic, so which is not so nice to travel. So I've mentioned OpenStreetMap a few times, and I think most of you know it, but just a few words about it. It's a free large geodatabase, and a bit simplified means in this geodatabase there are stored points, lines, areas. Points are the easiest to understand. It's just a point somewhere, for example, point of interest. Lines can be roads, and areas, for example, buildings or well, nature reserve parks and something like that. And everything of these points, lines, areas, and there are some more features which I ignore for simplicity, have attributes with a simple key value format. The good thing, or and the worst at the same time, there are no real standards for this key value pairs. There are of course some, I would call it best practices that are used for most things, but if you have a new application in mind, you can simply invent a new key, and if enough users adopt this, it's, well, it will be used sometimes in different applications. The OpenStreetMap is in some regions very, very detailed. For example, I'm living in the Ruhrgebiet now, and there you have, I think, mapped nearly everything, at least from my feeling. For most of the cycle paths, of course, the path itself is mapped, the surface is mapped, so if it's paved, unpaved, even often the pavement, if it's tarmac or if it's concrete or whatever, you get really, really much details. If you get in other regions, that's not so detailed, but it depends on the region, but I think in at least so North Europe is quite good mapped, and it's the base for very different applications. Not only for my cycle map, I think the best known maps are the OpenStreetMap maps on their website themselves, but they are not really the only users. Then I said something about you want to try to use contours, lines, or elevation, and there are, from the Shuttle Radar Topography mission, there are freely available data that is nearly, I think, nearly worldwide coverage. I think the poles are not really covered and some regions around, but else it's worldwide coverage. The resolution on the horizontal plane is about every pixel 90 times 90 meters. The vertical resolution, I think it was about 2 or 3 meters, but the problem is you have also some noise, because if there are many buildings, the radar has been reflected earlier, or if there are large forests. And there are some voids, especially in mountains, because if the mountain is steep enough, the radar has been reflected somewhere else and not back to the shuttle where the equipment was. So someone else set this website up, the viewfinder panoramas, and they improved the data with some other sources to fill in these gaps. And even some areas are now more detailed, but generally they are just filled in the gaps using other freely available data sources. I don't know which one exactly, but they have a bit more restricted license. So basically, SRTM data is freely usable, but the viewfinder panoramas has a bit more restricted license. I talked to them and they said, well, for your application, feel free to use them, but it's not really free license anymore. And then I switch over. I'm not sure if it's still a data source or already a tool, so I put it on this break, the GeoFabric. The GeoFabric is primarily a company that offers different commercial services around OpenStreetMap. So you, if you wanted to have a nice large print version for an area or your own map with different styles or whatever, you can go to these guys, and I've heard more than once that they do a quite a good job. But for me, I'm using a feature they provide free of charge. They provide extracts for different regions out of this huge OpenStreetMap database. Because if you want to get OpenStreetMap data and you don't want to get the raw data, there are some APIs where you can get really small locations. But I'm for creating maps, I don't need a few square meters. I need few hundred square kilometers because I'm making maps for whole countries. And in that case, I need elsewhere to download the complete planet file, and it's called planet because it contains the whole planet. And of course, that's way too large to download it every few days, and you had to pre-process it. So I'm quite happy they offer me to getting the one file for each country I wanted to create a map, which is far smaller. I think Germany is currently about 2 GB, 2 GB, so it's manageable. Then another tool is PyTMap. It's a simple Python program, or not so simple, I think, that generates the contour lines from the SRTM data and makes an output in OpenStreetMap file format, so I can use this data format later to generate contour lines in the maps. Well, I don't know if everyone knows what contour lines is. Contour lines are in maps these lines that shows that on this line there's a elevation in the landscape. For example, 20 meter, 40 meter, 60 meter. And this line goes on the map where this elevation should be. So there's usually circular, and if you're going down a valley, they're getting closer, and well, in some regions near the North Sea, where it's very flat, of course, you see nearly no contour lines. But these are really helpful if you take a look at the map and you see many contour lines, you know it's getting very steep up or down. Then there's another small tool, it's called the splitter. It divides the input file in rectangular files with no overlap, with a limited number of objects in each of these output files. This is needed because the Garmin devices don't like if their map tiles getting too large. And so the splitter get some input, like I don't want to have, I think it's currently about 400,000 objects in each tile, and then the size of the rectangles and the number are automatically determined, and output files are created and later processed using MKGMap. And MKGMap is the main program for creating maps for Garmin devices, not only for cycle maps, but also for car maps, hiking maps. I think even someone created a map for horse riding, showing you where you can best ride your horse. It's under GPL license, written in Java, and these guys have done most of the work in reverse engineering the Garmin format. You have full control which OSM data should be integrated in your map. There's some style system I show in a few minutes. You have full control how your different elements, streets, point of interest should look. And a newer feature, new means in this case, I think 3 years, is you have address search support, which is very convenient. If you want to, where you go, you can type the address and don't have to find the GPS coordinates on the map and say, I want to go there. And of course, it was a routable map, so of course it has routing support. So let's take a look on the style scheme. For example, it's for some point of interest. In these two lines, I make some changes in the data. For example, if there's a bank with an ATM, some people take it with anonymity, bank and ATM together. As I said, the text in the or attributes in OpenStreetMap data has no defined structure, so different people take it different. And to make it easier to process this further, I unify in this step the data a bit. So I said, create two different anonymities, one for the bank and one for the ATM. Or another example, in Germany, some people use the German word for dentist, and to make it unify it, so I rename it to dentist to process this further. Then we see here the possibility to take different logos for the different point of interest. There are three entries. The first one is for fast food, where another tag called cuisine contains pizza. So in this case, the point of interest is assigned a different icon that indicates you can get pizza there, which is in hexadecimal 0A0A. And it's pointed up to level 2. Level 2 means different zoom levels. You have 5 of them, and the lowest is 0. That means only if you zoom very close to, in the map. And the highest is 5, where you have a very broad overview. So I said, if you're going to cycle, you might get hungry from time to time. So it's nice to see where you can eat in your surroundings, even if you don't zoom in very close. The same goes for the next slide, where is a general fast food point of interest, which is not pizza then anymore. Or here another later, the example is for the dentist. And that's only displayed at level 0 because I said, well, hopefully you don't need a dentist while you're driving, while you're cycling. And if you need one, you will search for the dentist. And then, of course, the routing support comes handy and you drive directly there. And of course, you have to decide in which level you show which point of interest, because else in cities, it gets very, very cluttered with point of interest. And that's also one of the things you have to take in care of. If you show too few point of interest, the map gets very boring if you're outside the cities. But if you're showing too much, you don't see anything inside a city, so you have to decide which is important for you. So the same goes for lines or for streets. You can reassign different texts or even delete these attributes. For example, if you have a one-way which can be driven in both directions with my bicycle, I delete the one-way tag because I'm not interested in it anymore. Or some people take bicycle paths with official, others take it with bicycle designated. So I unified it here again. Or some other tags are used, for example, bicycle like with the value agriculture, which I map it to destination. Then here is a rule that say, for example, if I'm on a footpath from different styles and I have no designated bicycle tag, so there's no bicycle tag on this footpath, I assume that I can drive there with the slowest speed, so road speed max, this is a special tag that MKGMAC evaluates later. MKGMAC road speed max, I set it to 0, and that it's also not used, it's very likely I set the road class max to 2, and this means the routing algorithm can use this path, because I say, well, as a cyclist, I can unmount my bike and become a pedestrian, but I don't really value that. But if it's really short path, might use it, so I'm allowing it there. And the last three lines are just one way which is drawn on the first three zoom levels, 0, 1, and 2. And on the first zoom level, it has a different drawing scheme. So the first value in the brackets is different. And you see some information like road class and road speed. As I said before, these are the possible influences on the routing. And of course, in the end, the level where it's been drawn. And the continue tag at the end of the first two means that it should evaluate this item, this road, further, so the other lines can be put in the map too. So let's get to my ugly tool chain. It has, since I've inherited the project, parts of the was already there, parts had been added later. I have a different cron job that generates on average, I think, 2 maps a day, 2 different countries a day. This cron job calls a small bash script, which calls the main end file, which using M4 for setting up the styles, and on demand you calling heatmap for the contour lines, downloading and creating the source code for splitter, MKG map. So the AND part, well, I'm not getting the best friends with AND, but I think that it's the most sensible part in the setup. And in the end, using async to get it back to the web server. But this huge tool chain has one really huge disadvantages. It had a really steep learning curve. I had begun with creating a map couldn't be that hard. Well, I think it was 2 or 3 weeks just getting to know where each error had really occurred. Was it an error in the my style files? Was it an error in the source code of MKGMAP? Was it some missing Racket in the ARND file, it's a huge mess if someone wants to get track on it, especially since the style files are generated using M4. So looking at the result takes some time for getting the root cause. So I would say everyone who wants to create a map, keep it really simple. I have thought more than once ripping out all and start clean again, but that would take so much time. I'm just currently not willing to put it into. Then the other problem is with such a large tool chain, everything breaks, not every time, but every few weeks. Some URLs change from files you need to download. They are different, not only the OpenStreetMap data, but there's some other information that needs to be downloaded. Then sometimes the data type changes. The compression is, the last thing I had, compression has been changed. You think it's quite simple. Before it was a zip file, now we have a gunzip file. But the problem was, zipped files could be opened by the splitter automatically. Tar-gzipped files not. So I had to fiddle around, not only change the different to the new URL, but also change my ARND file to cope with that. Then, since the OSM data is currently changing, you sometimes need updates for MKG map, and sometimes that has other dependencies. Last time was MKG map decided only to run with a newer Java version, so I had to update my build server to a newer Debian version. And a small simple fix was a nice evening fiddling around with different tools. So, is it worth? Well, there is still some demand. It's getting less. I've just looked yesterday at my traffic graph for this year, and especially in the winter, it was usually, I think, double, and the peak was last year around, I think, was 1,600 GB. So, usage is getting down, but it still means there are, on average, 300 to 400 users a month that download a bicycle map for some European country for my website. So I think still the effort, I do something good besides having my own map, which I really like. But to sum it up, the design can be controlled quite good with the style files, with the zoom level, the type file that controls the design. But creating good routing results is really hard because you have very limited influence on the rates. There are some implicit influence on the rates you can't change. For example, sharp turns is tried to be avoided. But with a bicycle, a sharp turn isn't that problematic. And then incline decline is ignored for Garmin devices. So if it's a bit shorter, you go down to the valley and up, and having very much fun seeing that there was a cycle path around. And if you start using road class and road speed to define the rate, you get better results. But it has a downside. The distance your device can route without any further waypoints gets down to, depending on the region, but from my experience, about 10 to 20 kilometers. So it's good enough if you want to go, if you're in a city and want to go somewhere, it still works. But if you want to go to a different city, it can be problematic, so you have to prepare it on your computer, putting the different waypoints. The other chance is keeping road classes constant on long paths. For example, using the cycle paths that are advertised as national or international cycle paths, and keep that the road class constant. I did it before, but that has the downside that it uses them as a motorway and makes large detours because it's nicer for routing. So I have to say, for routing, there are currently way better programs. Personally, I'm using the web version of the BRouter, which is also available for Android devices, to make the basic route if I were going somewhere where I wasn't before. Then make some minor adjustments to my personal preferences, and then create a route for my Garmin device using many waypoints. So to sum it up, I would say it was a good idea to start the map in that time because there was BRouter is quite new. There was no equivalent outdoor hardware in that time except for Garmin. But I think if someone is interested in using a routable map for cycling, I wouldn't nowadays say it's the best path to build your own maps for Garmin because other programs do it quite well, and for Android there's nowadays quite good outdoor hardware available too, even from Garmin if you still want to buy from them. Yeah, so I will come to the end. If you want to take a look on the map, it's on my webpage. And if there are any questions, feel free to ask me. No questions? Then, oh. The problem is that I can't really answer this because the Garmin device itself and the routing algorithm is in part still a black box. So from my experience, many changes in the road class and road speed that's meant to be mounting, unmounting, is tried to be avoided. But I can't say it definitely. If you using BRouter, you can set up different penalties, for example, for this. So there would be an added rate for each time. For example, BRouter has also penalties for each crossing where you have to give way because you have to break down. And it's yeah, potentially you can use it, but I'm not sure if it's really done. Then, thank you for your attention.